Good morning, everybody. It's good to be with you this morning on this great Mother's Day. So just wanted to kind of give you an update on how we're going to move forward from here. We're going to start having live services next Sunday, but we're going to try to make sure that we're keeping services down to around 30 people. So the plan right now is to have two services next Sunday. One of them will be at 9:30. The other one will be at 10:45. They will be shorter than our normal services, so the 10:45 service will still get out probably before we normally would have got out before. But you know, we need to know, like, are you guys planning on coming? You guys still feel like you need to stay home for a couple of weeks? I've heard from some of you I haven't. So if you could kind of let the elders know or me know which service you're planning on attending so that we can kind of get an approximate number. I mean, if there's only 30 people that are going to be coming next week, then we'll just have one service at 10:30. So just text me or call me so that we can kind of get a more accurate number. But that's the plan for now. We're going to try to make sure that people don't touch surfaces. So we're going to have people that designated to hold the doors open for people. If you feel the need to wear a mask, please do. We're going to also rope off every other row just so that we can keep families spaced 6 feet apart. You know, we're not going to do any kind of shaking of hands or any kind of greetings like that. We're going to greet people from 6 feet away. And we're not going to pass a plate or anything that could pass germs from one person to the next. We're going to try to make sure that we keep everything sanitized. We're going to have hand sanitizer in different places. So we're putting in a lot of place, you know, some practices that can help us to keep from passing this from one person to the next. So we want to try to do this as responsibly as we can, and we'll keep our ear to the ground to see if there's any huge spike in cases in our area. We'll, you know, change and go back to online at the drop of a hat if that's what we need to do. So these are kind of our plans coming forward. So basically the only thing we need from you guys for now is just to let us know if you're planning on coming, not planning on coming, you know, what service that you would plan on coming to, the 9:31 or the 10:45, so we can keep it all evenly spaced out. So, all right, we do have somebody that has COVID, and you know that, and so we're praying for her, and she's still doing all right. She's very weak, but just continue to pray for her, you know, over the next few weeks. Hopefully she can come out of this very well. All right, so let's begin with a word of prayer. Dear Lord, again, we just thank you for this Mother's Day, Lord, and we just thank you for the mothers in our life, Lord, and who have meant so much to us and have had such a big impact and influence in our lives, Lord. And we just pray that you really bless them today. And as we kind of talk about motherhood today, and not just motherhood, but parenthood and grandparenthood in general, Lord, we just pray that you give us insight. But above all, Lord, we just pray that we can honor you through every step of that. We pray that in your wonderful name. Amen.
Believe.
Read a passage of scripture here from 2 Timothy. I'm thankful to God, whom I have served with a clear conscience as my ancestors did, when I remember you in my prayers as I constantly do night and day. As I remember your tears, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I recall your sincere faith that was alive first in your grandmother Lois, then in your mother Eunice, and that I'm sure is within you as well. Because of this, I remind you to rekindle God's gift that you possess through the laying on of hands. For God did not give us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and self-control.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rachel and Shannon, and Jada is also here helping out on the technology side, and Carol as well. All right, I have never really been all that involved in hiring somebody, but I imagine that it's a pretty nerve-wracking experience trying to make sure that you go through that stack of resumes, make sure that you're able to pick somebody that really fits in with your company or whatever it might be. I think it's especially true about hiring a pastor. You know, I've never been on the other side of hiring a pastor, but I can imagine that it's pretty nerve-wracking as well, because, you know, here's somebody that you are putting in charge, somebody that you are creating as the spiritual leader in your church community that you care about, and I'm sure it's a very hard thing to try to find that person just by looking at a resume, just by looking at a few words on a single piece of paper. How are you supposed to find the right person based off of facts, just on one sheet of paper? I mean, you can make that thing say anything that you want, right? How can you really see the person behind the paper? And even if they put a reference section on there and you call up their references, are they going to put on their reference sheet people that are going to give them a negative review? Probably not. They're going to give you references of people that are going to say that they walk on water. So are you really getting an accurate picture of them that way either? So it's got to be very hard to hire somebody like that. Now, for instance, say you pick off a resume off the stack. So you're a hiring manager now, or I'm a hiring manager now, and we pick the resume up, and this is what it says under skills. Have an intuitive understanding of supply and demand economics. Have experience with the management of cash flows. Was a manager of supply line and delivery systems. Had a consistent clientele with a high satisfaction rate. So you pick that resume off, and you'd say, This looks pretty good. This guy sounds great, or this lady sounds fantastic. What if I told you that all those skills were learned by being a drug dealer? You know, by passing drugs on from, you know, big drug bosses down to the little guy. Then you might have a different feeling about what those skills entail. You can make anything sound good on paper. You know, when I was first applying for ministry jobs, I remember being told by a professor that you want to be as accurate as you can be, because you don't want there to be any surprises. You don't want to get down the road 6 months and the church thought you were one thing and then all of a sudden you're something quite different. You don't want that, because that's just going to be miserable for everybody around you. You want to give a very accurate picture of who you are. So I took that to heart, and so when I started applying for ministry jobs, that's how I laid out my curriculum vitae, which is just a fancy word for a resume, is that I wanted people to see me for me. I didn't want to, like, put anything on there that sounded flowery or was any different than what people would get when they saw me in person. And I remember I got chosen for an interview, and I was sitting next to this guy on the search committee, and he kind of leaned over, and he said to me, "You were kind of honest on paper here, weren't you?" And then he kind of implied that they almost didn't give me an interview because I was a little bit too honest. And then, kind of as a throwaway comment, I heard him turn to the person on the other side of him, and he says, "But maybe every pastor resume should read like that." So one thing that you probably could put on a resume, probably should put on a resume, but you shouldn't. You know, if you want to hire a job, you probably shouldn't. But it's the title of mother. You know, mother uniquely qualifies you for so many things, and it gives you so much experience and so many skills at so many different things, yet unfortunately, for some reason, it's frowned upon to put that on a resume. But think about all the things that a mother does. You know, a good mother is as a household CEO. I mean, she just runs things. You know, has a master's in patience. You know, by the time your kids especially get through the teenage years, you've probably learned a lot of patience. Familial law enforcer, we could say that, right? When there's fights between siblings, they have to kind of moderate those. Activity coordinator, I mean, mothers do a lot of that, right? They coordinate different kinds of activities for their children to do. Playground medic, chef, you know, crisis negotiator, search and rescue, monster hunter, like, you know, kid comes to you and says, "I got a monster under my bed," and then you got to go and you got to try to tell them that there is no monster or hunt it down. You know, college application advisor, counselor, you know, when they're going through rough times, spiritual leader, safety commissioner, art critic, you know, repair specialist, anger management specialist, tutor, fashion stylist, you know, personal shopper, dental hygienist, chauffeur, party planner. We could go on and on and on. All of the skills that motherhood gives to you, all the experience, and so many different things that mothers do, they have so much influence. So you should be able to put it on your resume even though that's probably generally frowned upon. You know, there's a reason why there's a joke that when you go into the therapist's office and you sit down on the couch and you take a look at the therapist and he says, the first thing out of his mouth is, tell me about your mother. The reason why is because mothers have such a big impact on their children and on their families. And really, I think mothers have a huge impact on our culture at large. And they are something that's to be celebrated, and that's what we do as a culture, is we set aside this particular day of the year to do just that, to hold up motherhood and to celebrate it and to honor it. So I want to talk about another resume today, and that's the resume of Timothy. You know, Timothy was quiet. He was mild-mannered. We don't really hear him speak in the New Testament at all, yet he is a rock star of the New Testament. He is absolutely everywhere. Two books of the Bible are written specifically to him, right? 1 Timothy and 2 Timothy. Paul wrote them to Timothy. You know, also, his presence is felt all over the place. You know, in all sorts of other letters of Paul, we see Timothy come up. We see lists of characteristics about him. We learn a little bit about his family in different spots. And so Timothy's presence is felt all over the place. And so I want to talk about a few characteristics of him that if I were Timothy, I would put on my resume. You know, if I were writing Timothy's resume, I would put it on there for him. These are also things that you probably wouldn't put on a modern resume, but why wouldn't we? Why shouldn't we put these kinds of things on our resume? So I'm going to kind of go through a list here from 2 Timothy chapter 1, and we're also going to look at Philippians chapter 2 as well, and we're going to learn some things that were true about this great young man of the faith. All right, so let me read to you this passage that comes from 2 Timothy 1, 3-7 that we just read a few minutes ago. But I thank God whom I serve as my ancestors did, with a clear conscience, as night and day I constantly remember you in my prayers, recalling your tears. I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I'm reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois, and then in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For the Spirit of God gave us not a spirit of timidity, but gives us a spirit of power and love and self-discipline. So we actually see quite a bit, I think, about Timothy's character here and about Timothy's resume. You know, highlighted from the very beginning is that his faith was sincere. And this is going to be very important because I think this is one of the main ideas of what I'm trying to say today, is that Timothy had a sincere faith. And we see how that kind of evidenced itself in that he wept for his people that he was pastoring. He cared about them so much that it caused him to get emotional, that it caused him to get down on his knees to intercede for them. You know, the people that he was given charge over them, he loved them with every fiber of who he was. So it seems like, as we read 1 and 2 Timothy, there were some people that were leaving the faith behind, and they were going after false teaching. And so that meant that Timothy really had to learn how to stand his ground, even if that might be hard. And so Timothy kept at them because he wanted them to spiritually succeed. He wanted them to move forward with the Lord. Now, there's an old saying that no one cares how much you know until they know how much you care. And I think that's very true, right? If somebody doesn't believe that you're sincere, if somebody doesn't believe that you have their best interests at heart, they're not going to care about all the knowledge that you've accumulated in your head. They want to know, first of all, does this person care about me? Do they have my best interests at heart? Do they want me to go forward in a better way? Or are they in this for themselves? And so we learn from Timothy that his faith was absolutely sincere, that he loved his church deeply and sincerely. So here are some things that I think that Timothy should have put on his resume, right? So we're going to go with bullet points here. First bullet point that Timothy should have put on there, pure heart. And then what Paul says? Paul says, you have a pure heart. So what does that mean, that someone has a pure heart? Exactly what is that? Well, I think it kind of goes back to motivations, doesn't it? Like, when we say somebody has a pure heart, don't we mean that they have their heart in the right place? That they are trying to go in the best direction possible for as many people as are involved? You know, somebody who has a good heart has everybody else's good intentions in their mind first. Not only do they have good intentions, but that those good intentions kind of work their way out into their attitudes and their actions, which means that they end up leading by example. They are people who practice what they preach. You know, how somebody lives is always going to speak louder than what they say. Unfortunately, I think the opposite's often true, though, is that what people say kind of matters more than what they do. But I don't think that's how it should be. And in the end, if you really want to impact people and influence people, I don't think that's how it will be. I think that what people are going to follow is what you do, is going to be your attitudes and your actions, not just what you say. So Timothy had a pure heart, so we could put that up there put that on his CV, put that on his resume. Second, he had a good conscience, right? Paul says that you have a good conscience. Now, what does that mean? Well, we get a couple of hints from other parts of the Bible. Now, this one comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 12. For our proud confidence is this, the testimony of our evidence that in holiness and godly sincerity, not in fleshly wisdom, but in the grace of God, we have conducted ourselves in the world and especially towards you. Okay, so Paul is looking back on his ministry in certain areas, and he's specifically talking about his relationship with the Corinthians, and he says, I have a good, clear conscience. Meaning, when I was with you, I did the things that I thought were necessary. I did the things that I thought were right. And as I look back on it, I'm not second-guessing it. I'm not having any kinds of regrets. I said I did what I had to do. I behaved how I thought I should behave. The attitudes that I had and the values that I had were what I thought I should have. And so he has a clear conscience as he's dealing with them today. No regrets. I think that's part of having a clear conscience is living in this consistent, sincere way so that when we look back on our life, we don't have all those regrets, but that we think to ourselves, yes, in that situation, I did what I thought I should do. You know, Peter says it this way in 1 Peter 3:16, keep a good conscience so that when you are slandered, those who despise your good deeds in Christ may be put to shame. In other words, stay above board, you know, stay with integrity. You know, look back at your life with no regrets. Try as much as you can to live the values that you say you espouse. And in that way, when people accuse you of doing wrong, any third party that's watching is going to say, that's just not true. That's not the person that I know. I have seen how they walk. You know, they walk what they talk. There's no difference between what they say and how they are living their life. And I think we see that in Timothy. He had a pure heart, good motives. He had a clear conscience. He was living with no regrets. He was living out the values of Jesus, always treating people with kindness and love. And third, we see that he had a sincere faith. His faith was sincere. He did not just pretend to be faithful. He did not pretend to be spiritual. He really was faithful and spiritual. He not only believed the truth about Jesus, but he lived the truth about Jesus. And so because Timothy was pure of heart and clean of conscience and sincere of faith, you know what else he was? He was an influence. He was a godly influence in the lives of people around him. And this spiritual resume is reiterated in other parts of Scripture as well. So I want to turn to Philippians chapter 2 here. Philippians chapter 2, and we're going to get another picture of Timothy. And it starts in verse 19 of Philippians chapter 2. Now, I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon so that I too may be encouraged by hearing news about you. For there is no one here like him, like Timothy, who will readily demonstrate his deep concern for you. Others are busy with their own concerns, not with the concerns of Jesus. But you know Timothy's qualifications, that like a son working with his father, he served me in advancing the gospel. So I hope to send him as soon as I know more about my situation. So think about that resume there that Paul's giving to Timothy, this reference that he's giving. I have no one else like him. I believe that if I send him to you, it's as if I'm there. So you got to remember that the book of Philippians is a prison epistle, which means that Paul wrote it when he was in prison. And we don't necessarily know exactly which imprisonment. You know, we think that Paul had three. One was in Ephesus, most likely. Another one was in Caesarea. And then the third one, he was under house arrest in Rome after he appealed to Caesar. So three different imprisonments. But at some point during those imprisonments, Paul wrote this epistle to the Philippian church that he had planted. And he knew that somebody needed to be there and to kind of exercise some leadership. Problem is if you're in prison, you can't just, you know, pick up and go to Philippi. And so you have to send somebody else in your place, somebody that you respect, somebody that you think has the church's best interest at heart, somebody that you think is not going to do any harm, somebody that you think is going to do good and be a great influence there. And so who does Paul decide to send? He decides to send Timothy. And listen to what he says. He's looking at all the people that he has surrounded him, which are probably a lot of good, godly people. And he says, I'm going to send to you Timothy because I have nobody else like him. There's nobody else. Everybody else is busy worrying about themselves, but not Timothy. Timothy is worried about God. Timothy is worried about God's people, and he is wanting to put those people above himself, put their needs above his own. So I'm going to send you Timothy until I can be there myself and in person. What a great thing to say about somebody. That makes Timothy unique, right? He's unique because he genuinely cares about people above himself. Most people do look out for number one, but not Timothy. And he proves this over and over again by his attitudes and his actions. And that's why Paul decides to deploy him on his behalf. And so this agrees with what we saw in 2 Timothy chapter 1 as well. It also agrees with, you know, what we learned about Timothy from 1 Timothy. Not only did he do the right things, not only did he believe the right things, but he just valued the right things. His attitudes were right. His motives were right. His attitudes were sincere. And that's what we get here, is that his faith was sincere. He was authentic. You know, what you saw was what you got. He didn't put on a show. He didn't put on a mask. He didn't pretend to be something other than what he was. That's a sincere faith, humility, authenticity, and caring about people before yourself. You know, if we look at Philippians chapter 2, you know, right at the beginning, Paul talks about how, as believers, we need to be humble. And that means that we consider other people's needs above our own. And as you go throughout Philippians chapter 2, you'll see that there are four examples of this kind of humility. There is Epaphroditus, who went and helped the believers, even though he was sick, got sick for the cause of Christ. We see Paul. Paul talks about himself, how he poured himself out as a drink offering, as a sacrifice for the needs of other people. There's Timothy, you know, no one else like him, who genuinely cares about your needs above his own. And then there's Jesus. And we get this great example where Jesus gives of himself. He empties himself, and becomes a human being and lives on this earth and dies a sacrificial death. Why? Because he had other people in mind, not himself. So it's interesting. If I were to write Philippians 2, I would kind of go from least to greatest, right? I would start with my own example, Paul, and then he would move on to Epaphroditus, and then move on to Timothy, and then as the crown of Philippians 2, you know, we would talk about the work of Jesus. That's not what Paul does. You know, Paul reverses all that. He starts out with the great example of the self-giving nature of Christ. And he says, look at these human, real human examples of what that looks like. And Timothy ends up being that example. This is what it's like to be Christ-like, to look to other people's needs above your own. And when you do that, when you have that kind of sincere faith, you will be a good influence in the world. You know, I had a friend who their church had decided that they were going to kind of move on from their previous statement of faith, create a new one. And a couple people in the congregation thought, you know what, why do we always have a statement of faith that just lists right doctrine? Because that's what statements of faith are, right? We believe in God the Father, Almighty Maker of Heaven, and we believe in Jesus Christ, the only begotten, and on down the list of things that you believe. He says, why don't we ever include in it things that we should do or right practices? We're always about right doctrine, but why shouldn't our statement of faith also have right attitudes or right doctrine? And so they ended up putting in their doctrinal statement not only an orthodoxy section about the right doctrine, but an orthopraxy section about right practice. So I've got a little Venn diagram there that we're going to put up, and there are three circles there. You know, one is right doctrine, orthodoxy. Another one is right practice, orthopraxy. And the other one's orthopathy, which just means right emotions or right passions or right direction. And so right in the middle of all those things, that's where Christianity should be, because it's not just about believing the right things. It's not just about doing the right things. It's about valuing the right things that will come out in our beliefs and will also come out in our behaviors. Maybe you've heard me say it this way before. The point of Christianity is to cultivate in our hearts a faith so strong that it leads to faithfulness, a faith in the person of Jesus and in the Word of God so strong that it busts out the seams of us in our attitudes and our values and our actions. That's what this is all about, a faith that leads to faithfulness. And that's exactly what we see in the life of Timothy. He didn't just believe the right things. It wasn't about just doctrine. He also imitated the sacrifice and the example of Christ. And so Timothy becomes a rock star, a class act. But how did he get that way? Well, maybe he was just a genuinely good guy. I think that's part of it. Maybe, you know, he was filled with the Spirit. I think that's also part of it. We could also say that he was mentored by Paul. I mean, Paul probably taught him a thing or two, not only about right doctrine, but also about right belief and behavior and values. That's probably true as well. But we get another clue here, don't we, in 2 Timothy chapter 1. We see that Timothy's spiritual DNA not only came from Scripture and from Paul and from the Spirit, but it also came from his mother and his grandmother. Listen to what Paul says here. I recall your sincere faith, which first of all lived in your grandmother Lois and then in your mother Eunice, and now I'm convinced lives in you too. So this sincere faith that we see from Timothy wasn't just in Timothy. We see that this was a family trait. It was in his mother, Eunice. It was in his grandmother, Lois. And these things were passed on, and they weren't passed on by genetic code. They were passed on by example. Timothy was able to see them live out their faith sincerely, and so he wanted to live out his faith sincerely as well. So part of who Timothy was, part of the reason he turned out to be the way that he was because of good godly influences in his family, his mother and his grandmother. You know, it's hard to ever know the impact that we're having on somebody, even our own children, because we don't really have a control group, right? We've been talking a lot about control groups with this COVID thing. But think about it. There's no control group for your kid. You know, we raise our kid. We're part of their life. You know, we can't have an alternate reality where we weren't part of their life and see, okay, how did they turn out differently? And so it's hard to kind of measure exactly what kind of impact we have. But you have an impact. Parents, grandparents have huge impacts on their kids. And that can be positive and it can be negative. The question is which one is it going to be for you? How are you going to choose to live out your faith? How are you going to choose to live right in the plain sight of your children? Because it's going to make a big difference to what kind of influence that you're having. So you can't say, well, I really don't want to be an influence because I'm not a very good one. You have no choice in the matter. You know, with kids and grandkids, you are an influence, whether you want to be or not. So the question is how do we become a good influence like Lois and Eunice were? You know, when I was in high school, I think it was junior or senior high school, I led this small group of 7th and 8th grade kids. So, you know, we would have church on Sunday nights, and they would have just, you know, different things for the kids, and one of them was for the junior high boys. And so I led that for about a couple years. And I really wanted to minister to those kids. I didn't just want to teach them a couple of Bible stories. I wanted to get to know them, and I wanted them to see me live out Jesus so that they could as well. And so I would hang out with them every once in a while outside of the Bible study. So one of them I went bowling with, and another one I was teaching to play guitar, and you know, just different things just to be able to reach out. Okay, then you move on with your life, they move on with their life, and you never really know, did you have an influence, didn't you have an influence? Well, a couple years ago, I got a call from one of those students, and they hunted down my number just to tell me that I'd been a positive influence on their life. And he and his wife are youth leaders at their church. Couldn't be more proud of them. You never know. Even the littlest of things can be have a big impact on somebody. We just never know. And I'm going to tell you, as a mother, as a father, as a grandmother, as a grandfather, your influence is profound. Just by existing, you have such a huge impact on your families. Whether you know it or not, whether you care about it or not, whether it's good or it's bad, you are an influence. And I think that means that as Christians, we have a responsibility to be good influences, to try to lead our children, not only to become good, solid, upstanding citizens in this world, but also to pass our faith on to them as well. And so that means that we need to have a sincere faith, I think, like Lois and Eunice, because those are the kinds of faith that are going to pass on. So here's some statistics today. I don't want to bore you with stats, but I just want to mention a couple that are very important. All right, so 66% of students that grow up in the church, when they reach college age, will leave the faith. Okay, so that's the modern statistic in America today. And the Pew Research poll is actually as high as 75% of students will leave the church. So somewhere in between 66 and 75%. Now, statistics also say that some of them will return, you know, once they have a family and definitely once they have kids. But that's just a huge number, that two-thirds of students leave the church when they reach college age. And so I have kind of a slide up there that talks about the exit of millennials, but Generation Z is no different. The stat really hasn't changed very much over the past 20 years. So just a staggering statistic. 2 out of every 3 teenagers that grows up in the church will leave the church. And if you break that down, over half of those that leave cite some version of insincere faith as the reason. That means that 1 out of every 3 teenagers will leave the church, and they will leave the church because they see a disconnect between what people say and how they live. Okay, so that should be a pretty sobering statistic. Now, here's the more positive side of it. 1 out of 3 stays in the church, of course, simple math, right? And half of those cite that the main reason that they stayed in church was because of the sincere faith of a family member, of a family member. The actual wording of the question was this: they wanted to follow in the example of a parent or other family member. Half of the kids that stayed in the church did so because of the influence of a parent or some other family member. The other half cited the church was helping them become a better person, or that the mission and purpose of the church was something that they agreed with. So all of these things really have to do with sincere faith, people who live what they say, you know, especially parents and grandparents who live what they say, whose values and actions reflect the character of Christ. So as a mother, as a grandmother, as a father, as a grandfather, our influence is great. Just because we have a sincere faith, I'm not saying that you're automatically going to pass it on to your kids, but let me tell you something, it's a huge contributing factor. Now, who wants to follow after people? Who wants to do things that somebody who says one thing and does another does? I mean, it doesn't really make that much sense, because you're going to look at that and you're going to say, hey, they're not consistent at all. If they're not consistent, do they really believe this at all? So we need to work towards authenticity and sincerity like we see in Lois and Eunice and Timothy if we want to have a good influence in this world and a good influence on our children and grandchildren. So Timothy was impacted by the sincere faith that he saw in his mom and grandmother. And I think that's an encouraging thought, that we are a big influence in this world, and that sometimes we don't feel like we're making a difference, we are making a difference. So it's an encouraging thought. At the same time, I think it's a sobering thought, that sometimes we feel like we're not having an influence, we are. Now, interestingly, the stats are not much different for students who grow up in a vibrant youth ministry versus those who grow up in a church that doesn't really have that great of a youth ministry. And I think what that tells us is that, you know, I think some parents have this idea, well, I'll farm my spirituality and spiritual mentorship, I'll farm that out to the church. You know, that's what we pay the youth pastor for. They'll do it. Well, that doesn't seem to work either. You know, the greatest influence in a child's life is always going to be their family. It's always going to be their parents and grandparents. And so I hope that we are people who really, truly, and sincerely live what we believe. I hope that's us. I hope that's you. I hope that's me. And that should be celebrated. Sincere faith and sacrificial love, just like we see from Timothy, and just like we see in his mother and his grandmother. All right, so how do we do this? How do we cultivate this kind of sincere faith? And so I have six things that I want to share. First of all, we need to learn to be authentic. We need to learn to be authentic. Don't pretend to be somebody that you're not. Don't live by a different set of standards when you're with your friends versus when you're at work versus when you're at home versus when you're at church, because people see that. I mean, people can automatically see, well, this person kind of has a different set of values depending on who they are around. This person kind of cleans themselves up depending on who they are around. And your kids, especially, are going to be able to spot that kind of hypocrisy from a mile away. We need to live what we believe. This also means that when we make mistakes, we should own up to it. You know, I've just seen this so often in the political world where, you know, somebody makes a mistake. It's clearly a mistake. Everybody around them knows it's a mistake, but they go forward pretending like, oh, I meant to do that all the time. You know, I have a lot more respect for somebody who says, you know what? I thought this was the best thing at the time. It wasn't the best thing at the time. I'm really sorry. I'm going to do better next time. I have a lot more respect for that than for somebody to say, I'm perfect. Everything that I do is always correct. Everything I do is always right. So we're going to make mistakes. You're going to make mistakes. I'm going to make mistakes. And really, those can be opportunities to be authentic and to say, you know what? I shouldn't have done it that way. I should have done it some way different. I'm sorry if that hurt you. You know, have you ever met somebody that has a voice that they normally use in everyday conversation, and then they have a phone voice, right? And their phone voice sounds completely different than their normal voice. And so they can be yelling at their kids, and then they pick up the phone, and they got this really nice, sweet voice. Hello, how are you doing? Their voice goes up about an octave. You're like, wait a second. So why do you have a different voice on the phone than you have with everybody else? Why are you talking to a stranger different than you talk to your own family members? To me, I want my voice to be the same no matter what. You know, I've seen this in preachers too. Like, you know, the person that you meet and you talk to on the ground is completely different than the person you see up behind the pulpit. They talk differently. They move differently. It's really strange to me, because I've always been of the opinion that, you know, I want to get up and just talk to people. I want to be myself, be authentic as I possibly can be honest about, hey, we're all, you know, listening to the word of God. It's not as if the person up front knows everything that's going on, knows exactly what to do, and is trying to lecture the other people who don't. You know, we are all here trying to learn from God's word. And I think that fosters authenticity. So authentic people are people who are the same no matter what. Whether you catch them at the bowling alley, whether you catch them at a church service, whether you're in their home, it doesn't matter. They are the same person. They live by the same values. They say the same things. So we need to be authentic. We need to be alive. That's the second thing. You know, Paul tells Timothy here in 2 Timothy 1, this faith was first of all alive in your grandmother Lois and then in your mother Eunice. The English Standard Version says that it dwelled in them. It was part of who they were. It resided in them. Faith was something that was inside them that so strongly that it burst out of the seams and came out in the way that they lived their life. And so it was a living faith. It wasn't something that they could just put up on the shelf and just say, well, I'll pull it out when I need to. It was a part of who they were. It was alive. Third is that we need to learn to pass our sincere faith on. Now, not only did this faith live in Lois, it also lived in Eunice, who in turn both passed it on to Timothy. And so this faith for them, definitely for Lois, probably for Eunice as well, would have started as a Jewish faith, you know, a hope in a coming Messiah. Paul came to Philippi and told them, hey, this coming Messiah is Jesus. And they decided they were going to put their faith in him and they were going to follow his example. And Timothy witnessed this. He witnessed them kind of coming to terms with the fact that their Judaism was fulfilled in this person of Christ. They saw it sincerely in how they lived, and he wanted some of that as well. And so healthy things grow. Healthy things are things that we want to share. And when we want to share it, it becomes contagious. So I don't know if you've ever met a person, you know, who's just excited about something strange. But oftentimes they're so excited about it that you want to check it out. Even if you think in the back of your mind, that's not really all that great. You just feel like you want to check it out because they're so excited. So just imagine that I came to you and I'm just preaching to you the good news of Taco Bell. I'm like, Taco Bell is an amazing restaurant. They have great deals and their food is amazing and their service is extraordinary. You really got to try Taco Bell. And you're scratching your head and you're saying, I've been to Taco Bell. I don't remember it being all that great. But this person makes me want to go try it again. And that's the kind of thing we see with Lois and Eunice, is that they were so excited about their faith in Christ that it was absolutely contagious. It wanted people, when they saw it, wanted to give it a second chance. This sincere faith, it lived in your grandmother Lois, it lived in your mother Eunice, and now I see it in you as well, Timothy. So the question is this kind of living faith in us as well? And will we influence people and will we pass it on? The fourth thing that we can do to cultivate this sincere faith is just do. Just do. And this is what Paul says here in 2 Timothy 1. He says, Timothy, I want you to fan into flame this gift of God that he has given to you. Fan into flame. I think this is a great image, right? I mean, just think about starting a fire. You know, you get something really small, maybe paper or whatever, and you try to light it. And once it's lit, you know, it's really tiny flame and you're trying to make sure that it doesn't go out. And so you're trying to give it a little bit of oxygen, not enough to blow it out. And then you're trying to give it fuel, you know, a little bit bigger sticks and then a little bit more bigger sticks and then bigger until eventually it's hard to put out, even if you wanted to put it out. And that's parenthood, I think. You know, Timothy's like, you know, fan into flame your own gift. But as parents, we have the opportunity to help our children, grandchildren, to fan into flame the gifts that they have, because God has given them gifts. God has given them talents. And we have the responsibility and really the privilege of trying to help them to grow those into something that is really useful. You know, it's kind of like a coach, right? Standing on the sideline, cheering people on, saying, yes, I know you can do this. And so we just need to do. Fifth, we need to encourage. You know, Paul tells Timothy here that his gifts were confirmed by the laying on of hands. Okay, so some people, I think, believe there's something magical about the process of laying on of hands. I'm not one of those people. I think it's an outward sign of something that's already going on internally in the heart. You know, the outward sign of laying on of hands is connected to this inward desire to see somebody to succeed, to say, I see these gifts in you. I see that this is something that God wants you to do, and I want to be part of it. I want to support it. I want to encourage you in this. And so there's the physical laying on of hands that represents the spiritual support behind it. And so it's the same thing, that we need to spiritually lay our hands on our children and grandchildren. Support them. That doesn't necessarily mean you're putting your hands all over them. It means that you are spiritually and emotionally supporting them as they try to figure this life thing out, pointing them in the right direction. You know, Vince Lombardi was a famous coach, and he once singled out a big guard for his failure to perform. Right in the front of everybody, he told him, you are a lousy football player, and it's all over for you today. I want you to go take a shower. 45 minutes later, Lombardi made his way down into the locker room, and there sits this guard, you know, sitting on the bench with his uniform still on, with kind of his head hung low. And so Lombardi sat down next to him, and he said, son, I just told you the truth. However, in all fairness to you, I should have finished the story. Inside of you, I believe that there's a great football player, and I'm going to stick by your side until that player comes out. So Jerry Kramer went on to become one of the all-time great guards in the history of football. You know, a little bit of encouragement, I think, goes such a long way. And so that's one way that we can kind of cultivate this sincere faith in our children, is that we can encourage them. And finally, we need to be bold. You know, Paul points out here in 2 Timothy, he says, the Spirit of God does not make us timid, but gives us power and love and self-discipline. Paul is calling Timothy to a bold faith. He's calling us to a bold faith, a faith that believes that when we step out, on the Spirit will be there to help us. You know, when I go over to a light switch and I flip the light switch on, I'm not sitting there wondering, I wonder if the electricity is going to get through this switch and get to the light so that it turns on. I just flip the switch and believe the power will be there. It's the same thing when I go and I get in my truck and I stomp on the gas pedal after I put the truck into drive. I'm assuming that when I hit that gas pedal, the power will be there that I need. And it's the same thing as we live for Christ boldly. We need to make the right choices and believe that God's boldness, the Spirit's boldness, will show up when we need it. And that boldness is going to come out in a radical and special love for God and His people, and a self-discipline that keeps us on the right track, even if we might fall. So who knows the impact that you're having? I know you're having an impact. Lois and Eunice had an impact on Timothy. You're having an impact on the people around you, whether that is your kids or your grandkids, or whether that's your siblings or your parents. It doesn't matter. You are having an influence. The question is what kind of influence is it? Is it a good influence? Is it an influence that's leading people to Christ and to Christ-likeness? Now, I want to end with a quote from Charles Spurgeon. This is what he said once. Never could it be possible for any man to estimate what he owes to a godly mother. Certainly, I have not the powers of speech with which to set forth my evaluation of choice blessing, which the Lord bestowed on me in making me the son of one who prayed for me and who prayed with me. How can I ever forget her tearful eyes when she warned me to escape from the wrath to come? How can I ever forget when she bowed her knees and with her arms around my neck prayed, oh, that my son might live for you? Let's pray. Dear Lord, again, as we think about the influence that one person has on another, Lord, help us to kind of analyze our own influence and our own example. Are we authentic people? Do we have a sincere faith? Do we live what we believe? Do we practice what we preach? Lord, and I know that each one of us has such a huge impact on this world, has such an huge impact where we work, definitely has a huge impact where we live. Lord, I pray that we can work at becoming great influences that follow in the footsteps of Timothy, that follow in the footsteps of Epaphroditus and Paul, ultimately all following in the footsteps of your son Jesus, who gave of himself for the needs of other people. Lord, we just want to thank you for mothers today and grandmothers, and Lord, we just appreciate them so much, Lord, and we just want to honor them this morning. We pray that in your wonderful name. Amen.